We're so glad you're here, because you're the missing cast members we need to pull off this theatrical experiment. Your job begins by taking a moment to silence those phones. Then look around for the nearest exit, in case Cupid sets more than hearts on fire. And finally, lean into the show. Stay alert, watch out for your feet if you're in the front rows, and get ready to join us in the crazy world of Gallathea.
For integrity is left for a peace offering unto Neptune.
Dear is the peace that is bought with guiltless blood.
I cannot say that, but he sendeth a monster called the Agar. Against whose coming, the waters roar, the fowls fly away, and the cattle in the field for terror shun the banks.
And she bound to endure that horror?
And she bound to endure that horror.
Doth this monster devour her?
Conveyed unto Neptune, a realm between both, it is not permitted to know and incurreth danger to conjecture. Now, Gallathea,
Here endeth my tale, and beginneth thy tragedy.
Alas, father, and why so?
Wouldst thou have been less fair and more fortunate, shouldst thou not repine that I have disguised thee in this attire? For beauty will make thee to be thought worthy of this god. To avoid, therefore, destiny, for wisdom ruleth the stars, I think it better to use an unlawful means, your honor preserved, than intolerable grief, both life and honor hazarded, and to prevent, if it be possible, thy consolation by my craft. Now, hast thou heard the custom of this country, eh? The cause why this tree was dedicated unto Neptune, and the vexing care of thy fearful father.
Father, I have been attentive to hear, and by your patience am ready to answer. Destiny may be deferred, not prevented, and therefore it were better to offer myself in triumph than to be drawn to it with dishonor. Hath nature, as you say, made me so fair above all, and shall not virtue make me as famous as others? Do you not know, or doth overcarefulness make you forget, that an honorable death is to be preferred before an infamous life? I am but a child, and have not lived long, and yet not so childish as I desire to live ever. Virtues I mean to carry to my grave, not gray hairs. Nature hath given me beauty, virtue, courage. Nature has healed me death, virtue, honor. Suffer me, therefore, to die, or let me curse that I was born, sith I may not die for it.
Well, alas, Gallathea, to consider the causes of change, thou art too young. I must find them out for thee.
too fortunate.
The destiny to me cannot be so hard as the disguising hateful. To gain love, the gods have taken shapes of beasts. And to save life, thou art coy to take the attire of men.
They were beastly gods, that lust would make them seem as beasts.
In health, it is easy to counsel the sick, but it's hard for the sick to follow wholesome counsel. What? Let us depart from the way of our fit.
Nymph, are you strayed from your company by chance, or love you to wander solitarily on purpose?
Fair boy, or god, or whatever you be, I would you knew these woods are to me so well known that I cannot stray, though I would. And my mind so free that to be melancholy I have no cause. There is none of Diana's train that any can train, either out of their way or out of their wits.
And what is this Diana? A goddess? Ooh. What her nymphs? Virgins? And what their pastimes? Hunting?
A goddess? Who knows it not? Virgins? Who thinks it not? Hunting? Who loves it not?
I pray thee, sweet wench! Amongst all your sweet troop, is there not one that followeth the sweetest thing, sweet love?
Love, good sir? What mean you by it, or what do you call it?
A heat full of coldness, a sweet full of bitterness, a pain full of pleasantness, which maketh thoughts of eyes and heart's ears, bred by desire, nursed by delight, weaned by jealousy, killed by dissembling, and buried by ingratitude. And this is love. Fair lady, will you any?
If it be nothing else, it is but a foolish thing.
Oh, but try, and you shall find it a pretty thing.
I have neither will nor leisure, but I will follow Diana in the chase, whose virgins are all chaste, delighting in the bow that wounds the swift heart in the forest, not fearing the bow that strikes the soft heart in the chamber. This difference is between my mistress Diana, and your mother, as I guess, Venus, that all her nymphs are amiable and wise in their kind. The other, amorous, and too kind for their sex. And so farewell, little god.
Diana, and thou, and all I shall know that Cupid is a great god. Oh, I will practice a while in these woods, and play such pranks on these nymphs that while they aim to hit others with their arrows, they shall be wounded themselves with their own eyes.
Me too, fair being my Philadelphia.
Thou knowest the customs of thy country, and I the greatness of thy.
Everyone thinketh his own child fairest, but I know that which I most desire and would least have is that thou art fairest. Everyone knows the fierceness of the monster Agar. Not child fairest. But should I disguise myself in affection and suffer need to perish by a fond desire, whom I may preserve by a sure deceit?
Dear father, nature cannot make me so fair as she hath made you kind, nor you more kind than me dutiful. Whatsoever you command, I will not refuse, because you command nothing but my safety and your happiness. But how shall I be disguised?
In man's apparel.
It will neither become my body nor my mind.
Wow, Philia.
For then I must keep company with boys and commit follies unseemly for my sex, or keep company with girls and be thought more wanton than becometh me. Besides, I shall be ashamed and so unwarily blab out something by blushing at everything.
Fear not, Philia.
Yo.
Fear not, Philia. Use make it easy. Fear must make it necessary.
I agree. Since my father will have it so, and fortune must.
Come, let us in, and when thou art disguised, roam about these woods till the time be passed and Neptune pleased.
What callest thou this sport on the sea?
It is called a wreck.
I take no pleasure in it. Of all deaths, I will not be drowned. One's clothes will be so wet when he is taken up.
What callest thou the thing we were bound to?
Laughter.
I would rather hang myself on a rafter in the house than be so hailed in the sea. There one may have a leap for his life. But I marvel at how our master speeds.
I dare warrant by this time he is wet shod. Did you ever see the water bubble as the sea did? But what shall we do?
You are now in Lincolnshire, where you cannot know far if you can devise means to catch them. There be woods hard by, and at every mile's end houses, so that if you sink on the land, you shall speed better than on the sea.
See, I will never sail more. I brook not their diet. Their bread is so hard that one must carry a whetstone in his mouth to grind his teeth. And the meat so salt that one would think after dinner his tongue had been powdered 10 days.
My mariner, that was a sweet life, to be pinned within a few boards, and to be within an inch of a thing bottomless. I pray thee, how often hast thou been drowned?
Fool! Now seest I am yet alive!
Why? But be they dead that be drowned. For you see, I thought they had been with the fish, and by chance caught in a net again. It is a shame a little cold water should kill a man of reason, when you shall see a poor minnow lie in it who hath no understanding.
Thou art wise from the crown of thy head upwards. Seek you new fortunes now, I will follow mine old. I can shift the moon and the sun, and know by one card what all you cannot do by a whole back. The lodestone that holdeth his nose, to the north, the 2 and 30 points from the wind. The wonders I see will make you all blind. You be but boys.
What boys?
I fear the sea no more than it shall water. My fools, it is but a liquid element. Farewell.
Oh, it were good we learned this cunning at the cards, for we must live by cosmage. We have neither lands, nor wit, nor masters, nor honest.
Nay, I would fain have his 32, that is, his 36 lacking 4 points. For you see, betwixt us there is not but 2 good points.
Well, let us call him back so we may learn those points. Yeah. Sirrah, a word, I pray thee. Show us thy points.
Will you learn?
Ah.
Then, as you like this, I will instruct you in all our secrets. For there is not a clout, nor guard, nor court, nor post, nor the ignorant lizard and special nature.
Well, we'll start with your points, for I like only points in this world.
North, north, and by east, north, east, north, east, and by north, north, east, north, east, and by east, east, north, east, east, and by north, east.
Oh, oh, ah! North, 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 east. I shall never do it. I will never learn a quarter of it. All right, I will try. North, north is by the west side. North.
North, north, north. I can go no further.
Is thy head lighted in the wind and thy tongue so heavy and want a rag? And once again say it.
I will never learn this language. It will get but small living. When it will be scarce, be learned until one be old. Oh!
Farewell! And if thy fortune succeed not your wits, you shall starve before thee sleep.
Was there ever such cozening? Come, let us to the woods and see what fortune we may have before they be made ships. As for our master, he is drowned.
Yeah!
Woo! I will this way.
I this.
And I this. And this day 12 months, let us all meet here again. It shall be, we shall either beg together or hang together.
Well, it skills not, so we be together. But let us sing, though we cry hereafter.
Okay. Rocks and sands and seas, farewell. Fire which dwelleth to hell. That's in a ship which drunk is real.
Takes all from death to kill you. Takes all from death to kill you. We swallowed in wet grapes.
All souse in their waves. What shall we do being tossed to shore?
Those cavern and their roar. Those cavern and their roar.
Roar!
Then no matter winter in fair or stormy weather.
And as we live, let's die together.
What happened, caper cuts a feather?
Hush, Gallathea, thou must frame thy affection fit for thy habit, and therefore be thought immodest, because thou art unfortunate. Thy tender years cannot dissemble this deceit, nor thy sex bear it. Ugh! Would the gods have made me as I seem to be, or that I might safely be what I seem not? Thy father doteth, Gallathea, whose blind love corrupteth his fond heart, and jealous of thy death seemeth to dote on thy beauty, whose fond care carrieth his partial eye as far from the truth as his heart is from falsehood. But why dost thou blame him or blab what thou art, when thou shouldest only counterfeit what thou art not? But whist, here cometh the lad. I will learn of him how to behave myself. I neither like my gait nor my garments, the one untoward, the other unfit, both unseemly. Oh, Phyllida! But yonder stayeth one. And therefore say nothing. But, oh, Phyllida!
I perceive that boys are in as great disliking of themselves as maids. Therefore, though I wear the apparel, I'm glad I'm not the person.
It is a pretty boy, and a fair. He might well have been a woman, but because he is not, I'm glad I am. For now, under the color of my coat, I shall decipher the follies of their kind.
I would salute you, but I fear I should make a piece of a leg.
If I durst trust my face as well as I do my habit, I might spend some time to make pastime. For what they say will of a man's wit, it is no second thing to be a woman.
All the blood in my body would rush to my face if he should ask me.
This question among men is common. Are you a virgin?
But why stand I still? Boys should be bold! But here cometh the brave train that will spill all our talk!
Godspeed, fair boy.
You are mistaken, lady.
Why? Are you no boy?
No, fair boy.
But I see an unhappy boy.
Saw you not the deer come this way? He flew down the wind, and I believe you have blanched him.
Whose deer was it, lady?
Diana's.
Ha! Ha!
Deer.
I saw none but mine own deer.
This wag is either wanton or a fool. Ask the other, Diana.
I know not how it cometh to pass, but yonder boy is in my eye too beautiful. I pray the gods and ladies think him not their dear.
Pretty lad, do your sheep feed in the forest? Or are you strayed from your flock? Or on purpose come ye to mar Diana's pastime?
I understand not one word you speak.
What? Art thou neither lad nor shepherd?
My mother said I could be no lad till I was 20 years old. Not keep sheep till I could tell them. And therefore, lady, neither lad nor shepherd is here.
These boys are both agreed. Either they are very pleasant or too perverse. You were best, lady, to make them tusk these woods whilst we stand here with our bows, and so use them as beagles since they have so good mouths.
I will. Follow me without delay or excuse, and if you can do nothing, yet shall you hallow the deer.
I'm willing to go.
Not for these ladies' company, because myself am a virgin, but for that fair boy's favor, who I think be a god.
You, sire boy, shall also go.
I must if you command.
And will if you had not.
Now, Cupid, under the shade of a silly girl, show the power of a mighty god. Let Diana and all her coy nymphs know that there is no heart so chaste but thy bow can wound, nor eye so modest but thy brand can kindle, nor thought so staid but thy shaft can make wavering weak and wanton. Cupid, though he be a child, is no baby. Oh, I will make their pains my pastimes, and so confound their love in their own sex, that they shall dote in their desires, delight in their affections, and practice only impossibilities. Whilst I drew in from my mother, I shall use some tyranny in these woods, and so shall their exercise in foolish love be my excuse for running away. I will see whether fair faces be always chaste, or Diana's virgins only modest. Else will I use both my shaft and my shift. And then, ladies, if you see these dainty dames entrapped in love, say softly to yourselves, we may all love.
Do silly shepherds go about to deceive great Neptune in putting men's attire upon women? And Cupid, to make sport, deceive them all and using a woman's apparel upon a god? Then Neptune, that has taken sundry shapes to obtain love, stick not to practice some deceit to show thy deity. And having often thrust thyself into the shape of beasts to deceive men, be not coy to use the shape of a shepherd to show thyself a god. Neptune cannot be overreached by swains, himself is subtle. And if Diana be overtaken by craft, Cupid is wise. I will into these woods and mark all, and in the end will mar all.
Oh! Oh! Whatever out of these woods!
For I shall have nothing but wooden luck!
There's nothing but the screeching of owls, or the croaking of frogs, the hissing of adders, barking of foxes, walking of hags. But what be these? Such fair faces can never have such hard fortunes. But what black boy is this?
What life do I lead with my master? Nothing but blowing of bellows, beating of spirits, and scraping of crosslets. It is a very secret science, for almost none can understand the language of it.
Sublimation? Almagation? Calcination? Rubification? Incorporation? Cementation? Cercination? Fermentation? Albrification? As many terms impossible to be uttered as the art to be compassed.
Let me cross myself. I have never heard so many great devils in such a little monkey's mouth.
Then our instruments. Kirkabex, limbex, descensories, vials, manuals, mural for imbibing and combining.
bellows malignative and endurative.
Oh, what language is this? Do you speak so?
And then our metals. Saltpeter, vitriol, salt tartar, salt perforate, resigal, argol, salt ammoniac, Greenworks lime, glass, unslicked lime, tartar alum, chalk ashes hair and whatnot. To make I know not what.
My hair began to stand upright. Did the boy make an end?
And it is such a beggary science. So strong in multiplication, in the end, to have neither gold, wit, nor honesty.
Then I am just a thy occupation. What fellow? Well met.
Fellow, upon what acquaintance?
Well, thou sayest the end of thy occupation is to have neither gold, nor wit, nor honesty. And methinks at a blush thou shouldst be one of my occupations.
Thou art deceived. My master is an alchemist.
What's that? A man?
Ooh. A little more than a man and a hair's breadth less than a god. I have known him of the tack of a point to make a bowl of a pint.
Well, then that makes thee never have a point. They all be turned to pots! But if he can do this, then he shall be a god altogether.
If thou have gold to work on, then thou art maids forever. For with 1 pound of gold, he will go on to pave 10 acres of ground.
How might a man serve him and learn his cunning?
Easy. First, seeing to understand the language of it, and specially mark these points. In our art, there are 4 spirits.
Nay, I have done if you work with devils.
Thou art gross.
What?
We call these spirits the grounds of our art, and, as it were, the metals more incorporative for domination.
Oh.
The first spirit is quicksilver.
Well, that is my spirit, for my silver is so quick that I have much ado to catch it. And when I have it, it's so nimble that I cannot hold it.
I thought there were a devil in it.
The second, orpiment.
That's no spirit, but a word to conjure a spirit.
The third, sal armoniac.
A proper word.
The fourth, brimstone.
Whoop! That's the stinking spirit. I know because it burns so blue. You see, for my mother would often tell me, when the candle burned blue, there were some ill spirit in the house. And now I perceive it to be the spirit brimstone.
Canst thou not remember these 4 spirits?
Let me alone to conjure them.
Now I also have to teach you our 7 bodies. So the first one is... Here cometh my master. This is a beggar! No! Such cunning men must disguise themselves as though they were nothing, for otherwise they will be compelled to work for princes, and otherwise be constrained to betray their secrets.
I like not his attire, but am enamored of his art.
An ounce of silver lined, as much of crude mercury, of spirits 4 being tempered by the bodies of 7, of multiplying it 10 times comes 1 pound, 8,000 pounds! And I'm to be on an ethnic beach and cold!
Is it possible?
It is more certain than certainty.
I'll tell you a secret. I stole a silver thimble. Dost thou think that he will turn it into a pottle pot?
A pottle pot? Nay, I dare warrant it's a whole cupboard of plate. Why, for of the quintessence of a leaden plummet, he is able to frame 20 dozen silver spoon. Oh, look how he studies. I dare venture my life that of his own breath he is now casting of how to make golden bracelets. Why, otherwise, of smoke he is able to make silver drops.
What do I hear?
Dost thou never hear how Jupiter came in a golden shower to Danae?
I know the tale.
That shower did my master make of a spoonful of tartar alum. But with the fire of blood in the air so corrosive, he is able to make nothing infinite. But whist, he espieth us.
Peter, do you loiter knowing that every minute increaseth our mine?
Well, I was happy to take air, for the metal came so fast I feared my own face would be turned to silver.
Ooh, but what stripling is this?
One that is desirous to learn your craft.
Craft, sir boy? You.
You must call it
mystery.
All is one, sir. A crafty mystery and a mystical craft.
Canst thou take pains?
Infinite.
Ah!
and then I shall entertain you.
I can swear, though I be a poor fellow, as well as the best man in the Shire. But, sir, I much marvel that you, being so cunning, should be so ragged.
My child, griffs make their nests of gold, though their coat be made of feathers. And we feather our nests with diamonds, though our garments be but frisé. If thou knewest the secret of this science, the cunning would makest thee so proud that thou wouldest disdain the outward pomp.
Oh, my master is so ravished with his art that many times we go supperless to bed. For he will make gold of his bread, and such a strong desire for his art that we all wish our very guts were gold.
I have good fortune to light upon such a master.
When in the depth of my skill, I do determine to try the uttermost of mine art. I am dissuaded by the gods. Otherwise, I durst to make the fire as it flames gold, the wind as it blows silver, the water as it runs lead, the earth as it stands iron, the sky brass, and men's thoughts firm.
I must bless myself and marvel at you.
Come in, and thou shalt see all.
Oh, I follow, I run, I fly. They say my father hath a golden thumb. You shall see me have a golden body.
Oh, yes! I am very happy for this, for now I have leisure to run away.
Oh, such a bald art as never was. Let him keep his new man, because he shall never see his old again.
Gallathea, miserable Gallathea, that having put on the apparel of a boy, thou canst not also put on the mind.
Oh, fair Meladius.
Aye, too fair, and therefore I fear too proud. Had it not been better for thee to have been a sacrifice to Neptune than a slave to Cupid? To die for thy country than to live in thy fancy? To be a sacrifice than a lover? Oh, when I hunted his eyes with my heart, he might have also seen my heart with his eyes. Why did nature to him, a boy, give a face so fair, or to me, a virgin, a fortune so hard? I will now use for the distaff the bow, and play at quoits of rock that was wont to sew in my sampler. It may be, Gallathea, foolish Gallathea, what may be? Nothing. I will now find the voice. Now, sweet Venus, be my doll.
Poor Philidor! Curse the time of thy birth and the rareness of thy beauty, the unnaptness of thy apparel, the untamedness of thy affections. Art thou no sooner in the habit of a boy? Thou must be enamored of a boy. What shouldst thou do, and what best liketh thee, most discontenteth thee? Go into the woods. Watch the good times, his best moods, and transgress in love a little of thy modesty. I will. I dare not. Thou must. I cannot. Then why did thy not peevishness? I will not. I will. Philidor, do something, nay, anything, rather than live thus. Well, what I will do, myself knows not, but what I ought, I know too well. Oh. And so I go, resolute, either to bewray my love or suffer shame. Beginnest thou with Pyralis to die in the air and live in the fire, to leave the sweet
sweet delight of hunting and follow the hot desire of love?
Oh, Talutha. These words are unfit for thy sex, being a virgin.
Oh, but apt for thy affections, being a lover. And can there in years so young, in education so precise, in vows so holy, and in a heart so chaste, enter either a strong desire, or a wish, or a wavering thought of love?
Can Cupid's brands quench Vesta's flames, and his fable shafts headed with feathers pierce deeper than Diana's arrows headed with steel? Break thy bow, Talusa, that seeks to break thy vow, and let those hands aim to hit the wild heart, scratch out those eyes that have wounded thy tame heart. O vain and only naked name of chastity, that is eternal and perisheth by time, holy,
and is infected by fancy divine, and made mortal by folly.
The virgin's hearts, I perceive, are not unlike cotton trees, whose fruit is so hard in the bud, it soundeth like steel. Oh, but being ripe poureth forth nothing but wool. Oh, Malavius! Because thou art fair, must I be fickle and false my vow because I see thy virtue? Fond girl that I am to think of love. Nay, vain profession that I follow to disdain love. Oh, but look, here cometh your rod. I must now put on a red mask and blush, lest she perceive my pale face blush. Talusa! Diana bid me hunt you out and say if you do not care to hunt with her. But if you follow any other game, she hath roused. Your punishment shall be to bend all our bows and weave all our strings. Why look you so sad, so pale, so wildly? Tirana, the game I follow is the thing I fly. My strange disease, my chief desire.
I am no Oedipus to expound riddles, and I muse how thou canst be Sphinx to utter them. But I pray thee, Talusa, tell me what thou ailest. If thou bist sick, this ground hath leaves to heal. If melancholy, here are pastimes to use. If peevish wit must wean it, or time, or counsel. If thou be in love, for I have heard of such a beast called love, it shall be cured. Why blushest thou, Talusa?
To hear thee in reckoning my pains to recite thine own. I saw, Eurata, how amorously you glanced your eye at the fair boy in the red coat, and how cunningly, now that you would have some talk of love, you hit me in the teeth with love.
I confess I am in love, yet swear I know not what it is. I feel my thoughts unknit, my eyes unstained, my heart, I know not how affected or infected. My sleep's broken and full of dreams, my wakeness sad and full of sighs, myself in all things, unlike myself. If this be love, I would it had never been devised.
Thou hast told me what I am in uttering what thyself is. These are my passions, Eurata, my unbridled passions, my intolerable passions, which I were as good great counsel to deny in your presence.
What how did it take you first, Talusa?
By the eyes, my wanton eyes, which conceived the very picture of his face and hanged it on the very strings of my heart.
Fair lady.
But how did it take you, Eurata?
By the ears. Oh, sweet words sunk so deep into my head that the remembrance of his wit hath bereaved me of my wisdom. Oh, eloquent Tigris. Oh, credulous Eurata! Soft, here cometh Ramia, but let her not hear us talk. We will withdraw ourselves and hear her talk.
I am sent to seek others and have lost myself.
You shall see Ramia hath also bitten on a love leaf.
Can there be no heart as chaste but love can wound? Nor vow so holy but affection can violate? Vain art thou virtue, now chastity. If love be a god, why not lovers be virtuous? Love is a god, and lovers are virtuous.
Indeed, Ramia! If lovers were not virtuous, then wert thou vicious?
What, are you come so near me?
I think we came here when you said you loved.
Tush, Ramia. 'Tis too late.
call it, to repent it a shame. Therefore, I pray thee, tell us what love is.
If myself felt only this infection, then I would take upon me the definition. But being incident to so many, I dare not myself describe it. But we will all talk of this in the woods. Diana stormeth that sendeth one to seek another, she loseth all. Servia, of all the nymphs, the coyest, loveth deadly, exclaimeth against Diana, honoreth Venus, detest Vesta, and maketh a common scorn of virtue. Clymene, whose stately looks seem to amaze the great lord, stoopeth, yieldeth, and fawneth upon that strange boy in the woods. Myself, with blushing, I speak it, am thrall to that boy, that fair boy, that beautiful boy.
Oh. What have we here?
All in love, no other food than fancy. No, she shall not have the fair boy.
Nor you, Telusa.
Nor you, Eurata. I love Meladius.
Meladius?
My desert shall be answerable to my desires. I will forsake Diana for him. I will die for him.
So saith Clymene, and she will have him.
I care not. My sweet Titus, though he seem proud, I view him to childishness, who yet being scarce out of his sloth pots can hardly understand these deep conceits. I love him.
So do I, and I will have him!
Modest that we all are, unfortunate all we are like to be! Shall virgins begin to wrangle for love in their thoughts? In their words? In their actions? Oh, divine love, which art therefore called divine, because thou overreachest the wisest, conquerest the chastest, and dost all things both unlikely and impossible, because thou art love. Thou makest the bashful impudent, the wise fond, the chaste wanton, and makest contrary to our reason, because thyself is beyond reason.
Talk no more, Telusa, your words wound. For my word, no woman.
We're timorous, we're no boy. And Telusa, we're no buddy.
Framed you not a woman, having a face so fair, so loving countenance, so modest a behavior.
There's a tree in Tylos whose nuts have shells like fire. And being cracked, their kernel is but water.
What a toy it is to tell me of this tree, being nothing to the purpose. I say it is pity you are not a woman.
I would not want to be a woman, unless it were because thou art a man.
Nay, I do not wish thee to be a woman, for then I should not love thee, for I have sworn never to love a woman.
Strange humor in so pretty a youth, and in mine own, for I myself have sworn never to love a woman.
It were a shame, if a maiden were a suitor, a thing hated in that sex, that thou shouldst deny to be her servant.
If it be a shame in me, it can be no commendation in you, for you yourself is of that mind.
Suppose I were a virgin, I blush in supposing myself one. And that under the habit of a boy were the person of a maid, if I should utter my affection with sighs, manifest my sweet love by my salt tears, and prove my loyalty unspotted and my griefs intolerable, would not then that fair face pity this true heart?
Admit that I were, as you would have me suppose that you are, and that I should, with entreaties, prayers, oaths, bribes, and whatever else can be uttered in love, desire your affection, would you not yield?
You come in with admit,
and you would suppose.
Doubtful speeches be these. I fear he is as I am, a
maiden.
What dread rises in my mind? I fear the boy is, as I am, a maiden.
Tush, it cannot be. His voice shows the contrary.
Yet I do not think it, for he then would have blushed. Have you ever a sister?
If I had one, my brother needs to have two. But I pray, have you ever one?
My father had but one daughter, and therefore I could have no sister.
He is as I am, for his speeches be as mine are.
What shall I do? Either he is subtle or my sex simple. I will once again try him.
You promised me in the woods you would love me before all Diana's nymphs.
You would love me before all of Diana's nymphs.
Can you prefer a fond boy as I am before so fair ladies as they are?
Why should not I as well as you?
Sit in the grove and make much one of another. That cannot tell what to think one of another.
Great! My boy is coming away! I trust I will not run after him.
I had a pair of wings so that I might fly after.
My boy was the veriest thief, the arrantest liar, and the vilest swearer in the world. Otherwise, the best boy in the world. Now, you've taken all my money, all my apparel, and forgot nothing but to bid me farewell.
That I will not forget. Farewell, master.
Why? Thou hast not yet seen the end of my art.
I would I had not known the beginning. Did you not promise me of my silver thimble you would make a whole cupboard of plate? And if that of a Spanish needle you would build a silver steeple?
Why, Rafe, the measure of this fortune... The fortune of this art consisteth in the measure of the flame. For if there be a coal too much or a spark too little, if it be a little too hot or a thought too soft, all our labor is in vain. And so it be, and often doth it happen, that the just proportion of the fire and all other things occur.
Concur, con-dog, I will away!
I'll run away!
Dog, an art, quoth you, that one multiplieth so much all day that he wanted money to buy meat at night. What have we here?
What devout man.
Well met! Well met!
He will not speak until he be urged. I will salute him.
Sir, there lieth a purse underneath your feet. If I thought it were not yours, I would take it up.
Dost thou know that I was calculating the nativity of Alexander's great horse?
Why, what are you?
An astronomer.
What, one of those that makes almanacs?
The pessimist.
What?
I can tell thee the minute of thy birth, the moment of thy death, and the manner. I can tell thee what the weather shall be between this and Octavius Emus Octavus Mirabilis Anus. When I list, I can set a trap for the sun, catch the moon with lime twigs, and go about fowling for stars. I can tell thee all things past and things to come, and with my cunning measure, how many yards are beneath the sky. Nothing can happen which I foresee not. Nothing shall.
I hope, sir, you are no more than a god?
I can break the 12 signs out of their zodiacs and hang them up at taverns.
I pray you, sir, tell me what you cannot do, for I perceive there is nothing so easy for you to compass as impossibilities. But what be those signs?
As a man should say, signs which govern the body. The round governeth the head.
Why, that's the worst sign for the head.
Why?
Because it's the sign of an ill you.
Tush, that sign must be there, then. Bow for the throat, Capricornus for the knees.
I will hear no more of signs, and they all be such desperate signs. But, seeing you are, I know not who to turn you. Shall I serve? I fain would serve.
I accept.
be.
Oh, happy I am, for now I shall reach thoughts and tell how many drops of water go into the greatest shower of rain. You shall see me catch the moon in eclipse like a coney in a person.
I will teach thee the golden number, the impact, and the prize.
I will meddle no more with the numbering of gold, for multiplication is a miserable action. But, sir, I pray thee, what weather shall we have this hour 80 years?
That I must cast by our judicials astronomical. Therefore, come in with me, and thou shalt see every wrinkle of my astrological wisdom, and I will make the heavens as plain to thee as the highway. Thy cunning shall sit cheek by jowl with the sun's chariot. Then shalt thou see what a base thing it is to have other thoughts creep on the ground, when as thine shall be stitched to the stars.
Then I shall be translated from this mortality.
Thy thoughts shall be metamorphosed, oh, and mailed hail fellows with the gods!
Oh, I feel my very brains moralized, and as it were, a certain contempt of earthly actions has crept its way into my mind. By an ethereal contemplation.
Oh, come, let us in!
What news have we here, ladies? Are all in love? Are Diana's nymphs become Venus's wantons? Is it a shame to be chaste because you are amiable, or must you needs be amorous because we're fair? Oh, Venus, if this be thy spite, I will requite it with more than hate. Well, shalt thou know what it is to drive thine arrows up and down Diana's legs. There is an unknown nymph that straggleth up and down these woods, which I suspect have been the weaver of these robes. I saw her, slumbering by the brookside. Go search her and bring her. If upon her shoulders you find a burn, it is Cupid. If any print on her back like a leaf, it is Medea. If any picture on her left breast like a bird, it is Calypso. Whoever it be, bring her hither, and speedily bring her hither.
I will go with speed.
Go to Larissa and help her.
I obey.
Now, ladies, doth not that make your cheeks blush and make my ears glow? Or can you remember, without sobs, that which Diana cannot think on without sighs? What greater dishonor could happen to Diana? Or to her nymphs? Shame, than that there could be any time so idle that should make their heads so addle. Your chaste hearts, my nymphs, should resemble the onyx, which is hottest when it is whitest. And your thoughts, the more they are assaulted with desires, the less they should be affected. Shall it be said, and shall Venus say it? Nay, shall it be seen, and shall wanton see it, that Diana, the goddess of chastity, shall have her nymphs to become unchaste in desires, immoderate in affections, untemperable in love, in foolish love, base love. I blush, ladies, that you, having been heretofore patient of labors, should now become apprentices to idleness, and use the pen for sonnets, not the needle for samplers. And how is your love placed? Upon pelting boys, perhaps base of birth, without doubt weak of discretion. Aye, but they are fair. O ladies, do your eyes begin to love colors whose hearts were wont to loathe them? Is Diana's chase become Venus's court? And are your holy vows turned to hollow thoughts?
Madam, if love were not a thing beyond a reason, we might then give a reason for our doings. But so divine is his force, that it worketh effects as contrary to that we wish as unreasonable against that which we are.
Lady, so unacquainted are the passions of love that we can neither describe them nor bear them.
Foolish girls. How willing you are to follow that which you fly. Here cometh Calypso.
Bird,
and he confesseth himself to be Cupid. Go. How now, sir? Are you caught? Are you Cupid?
Thou shalt see, Diana, that I dare confess myself to be Cupid.
And thou shalt see, Cupid, that I will show my
devourer of thy loose and untamed appetites! Did thy mother, Venus, under the color of a nymph, send thee hither to wound my nymphs? Doth she add craft to her malice and, mistrusting her deity, practice deceit? Is there no place but my groves, no persons but my nymphs? Cruel and unkind Venus that spieth only chastity. Thou shalt see that Diana's power shall revenge thy policy and tame this pride. As for thee, Cupid, I will break thy bow, burn thy arrows, clip thy wings, and fetter thy feet. Thou that fattest others with hopes shall be fed thyself with wishes, and thou that bindest others with golden thoughts shall be bound thyself with golden fetters.
Venus's rods are made of roses.
Diana's a Priony! Let Venus, that great goddess, ransom Cupid, that little god! These ladies here, whom thou hast infected with foolish love, shall both tread on thee and triumph over thee. Thine own arrows shall be shot into thine own bosom, and thou shalt be enamored not on Psyche's, but on Circe's. I will teach thee what it is to displease Diana, distress her nymphs, or disturb her game.
Diana, what I have done cannot be undone, but what you mean to do shall. Venus hath some gods to her friends. Cupid shall have all.
Are you prating? I will bridle thy tongue and thy power! And, in spite of mine own thoughts, I will set thee a task every day, which if thou finish not, thou shalt feel as smart. Thou shalt be used as Diana's slave, not Venus's son. All the world will see that I will use thee like a captive and show myself a conqueror. Come, have him in, that we may devise apt punishments for his proud presumption.
We will plague ye for a little god. We will never pity thee, though thou be a god, nor I.
Nor I.
Today is the day when you must satisfy Neptune. And save yourselves. Call together your fair daughters, and for a sacrifice, take the fairest. For better it is to offer a virgin than to suffer ruin. If you think against nature to sacrifice your children, think it also against sense to destroy your country. If you think Neptune pitless to desire such a pain, oh, then confess yourself perverse to deserve such a punishment. You see this tree? This fatal tree! Whose leaves, though they glister like gold, yet it threateneth the fair virgin's grief. To this tree! The beautifulest be bound to the monster Agar. Come and carry her away. And if the monster come not, then assure yourselves that the fairest is concealed. Then shall your country be destroyed. Therefore, consult amongst yourselves, not as fathers of your children, but as favors of your country. Let Neptune have his peace, if you will have your quiet. And thus I have warned you to be careful, and wish you be wise in knowing whoso hath the fairest dog hath the greatest fortune in losing one to suffer.
Unless I depart to provide ceremonies for the sacrifice and command you to bring me a sacrifice.
They say, dearest, that you have a fair daughter. If it be so, dissemble not, for you shall be a fortunate father. It is a thing holy to preserve one's country, and honorable to be the cause.
Nay, Meladius, I have heard you boast that you had a fair daughter, none of which was more beautiful. Hope you are not so careful of a child that you'll be careless to your country, or add so much to nature you'll detract from wisdom.
I must confess that I had a daughter, and I know you have, Titters, but alas, my child's cradle was her grave, and her swath caught her wanted sheet. I wish she would have lived till now. She should willingly have died now, for what could have happened to poor Meladius more comfortable than to be the father of a fair child and a sweet country?
Oh, Meladius, dissemble you may with man, deceive the gods you cannot. Did I not see you very lately see your daughter in your arms, when as you gave her infinite kisses with affection, I fear me more than fatherly? You have conveyed her away that you might cast us all away, bereaving her the honor of her beauty and us the benefit, preferring a common inconvenience over a private mischief.
It is a bad cloth, Tyrus, that will take no color, and a simple father that can use no cunning. You make the people believe you wish well when you practice nothing but ill, wishing to be thought religious towards the gods, when I know you deceitful towards me. You cannot overreach me, Tyrus. Overshoot yourself, you may. It is a wily mouse that will breed in the cat's ear. He must howl cunningly that will deceive the cripple. Did you ever see me kiss my daughter? You are deceived. It was my wife. So young, a priest unfit for so old a person, and therefore imagine it to be my child, not my spouse. The silver hairs delight in golden locks, and the old fancies crave young nurses, and the frosty years must be thawed by them. This matter set aside, you have a fair daughter, Titterus, and it is a pity you are so fond of father.
You are both either too fond or too forward, for whilst you dispute to save your daughters, we neglect to prevent our destruction.
Let us away and seek out a sacrifice. We must sift out their cunning and let them shift for themselves.
Cupid to, but things impossible.
Oh, I will do it.
Bingo!
he sleep not,
for love will be idle. Take heed you surfeit not, for love will be wanted.
Let me alone with him. I'll find him somewhat.
Why did Cupid punish us without pity?
Is love a punishment?
It is no pastime.
Venus, if thou sawest Cupid as a captive, bound to obey what was wont to command, fearing ladies' threats that once pierced their hearts, I cannot tell whether thou wouldst prevent it for despite or laugh at it for disport. The time may come, Diana, and the time shall come that thou that settest Cupid to undo knots shall entreat Cupid to tie knots, and you ladies that with solace have beheld my pain shall with sighs entreat my pity.
Come, Cupid. Diana hath devised new labors for you, which our god unknows.
You shall weave samplers all night and lackey after Diana all day. You shall shortly shoot at beasts for men, because you have made beasts of men. And wait on ladies' trains, because thou entrappest ladies by trains. All of the stories which are in Diana's Eris, which are of love, you must pick out with your needle. And in that place, so Vesta with her nuns and Diana with her nymphs. How you like this, Cupid?
I say I will prick as well with my needle as ever I did with my arrow.
Diana cannot yield. She conquers affection.
Diana shall yield. She cannot conquer destiny.
Come, Cupid. Hey. You must do your business.
You shall find me so busy in your head, you shall wish I could idle in your arms.
This day is solemn sacrifice at this tree, wherein the fairest virgin, were not the inhabitants faithless, should be offered unto me. But so overcareful are fathers to their children that they forget the safety of their country, and fearing to become unnatural, become unreasonable. Their sleights may blare men, deceive me, they cannot. I will be here at the hour and show as great cruelty as they have done craft. And well shall they know that Neptune should have been entreated, not causant.
I marvel what virgin the people will present. It is happy you are none, for it would fall into your lot because you are so fair.
If you have been a maiden too, I need not have feared because you are fairer.
I pray thee, sweet boy, flatter not me. Speak truth of thyself, for in mine eye of all the world, thou art the fairest.
These be kind words, but far from thy true thoughts. I know mine own face in a true glass and desire not to see it in a flattering mouth.
Oh, would I did flatter thee, and that fortune would not flatter me. I love thee,
as a brother. But love not me so.
No, I will not. But love thee better, because I cannot love as a brother.
Will not you be at the sacrifice?
No.
Why?
Because I dreamt that if I should attend, I would be turned to a virgin. And being so fair as thou sayest I am, I would be sacrificed, as thou knowest one must. But will not you be there?
Not unless I were sure a boy would be sacrificed and not a maiden.
Why, then you are in danger.
But I would escape by deceit. But seeing we are both resolved to be absent, let us wander these groves to the Albany Pass.
I am agreed, for then my fear will be past.
Why?
What dost thou fear?
Nothing. But that you love me not.
I will! Oh, poor Phillida, what shouldst thou think of thyself?
That lovest one that I fear me is as thyself is. And may it not be that her father practiced the same deceit with her that my father hath with me? And knowing her to be fair, feared she should be unfortunate? If it be so, Phillida, how desperate is thy case? If it be not, how doubtful? For if she be a maiden, there is no hope of my love. If a boy, a hazard! I will after him or her and lead a melancholy life that looked for a miserable death.
No more masters now. But a mistress, if I can light on her.
No.
An astronomer. Of all occupations, that's the worst. Yet well fare the alchemist, for he keeps good fires, though he gets no gold.
The other stands warming himself by staring upon the stars, which I think he can assume number as know their virtues. He told me a long tale of, Octogesimus Octavus and the meeting of the conjunctions in the planets, and in the meantime, fell himself backwards into a pond. I asked him why he foresaw not that by the stars. He said he knew it, but contemned it.
How?
But soft, is this not my brother Robin?
Yes, as sure as thou art right,
Robin! Robin, what news? What fortune?
Faith! For I've had but bad fortune, but I printed. Tell me thine.
I have had two masters, not of thy art, but of thy nature. And one said that with multiplying, he would make of a penny 10 pounds.
Ah, but could he do it?
Could he do it, quoth he? Why, man, I saw a pretty wench come into his shop wherewith puffing and blowing and sweating, he so plied her that he multiplied her. He made of her 1, 2.
What? By fire?
No, by the philosopher's stone.
What? Have philosophers such stones?
Aye, but they lie in a privy cupboard!
Oh! If thou art rich, if thou have learned this cunning.
This was nothing. He would of little fasting spittle make a hose and doublet of cloth of silver.
Oh, for if I were with him, for I have had no meat but spittle since I came into the wood.
How then didst thou live?
Why, man, I served a fortune teller, who said I shall live to see my father hanged and both my brothers begged, and so I concluded the mill would be mine. And I live by imagination still.
Thy master was an ass and looked on the lines of thy hands, but my other master was an astronomer and could pick my nativity out of the stars. I should have half a dozen stars in my pocket if I had not lost them all. Oh, wait, but here they be. Sol, Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, and Venus.
Why, these be but names.
Oh, aye, but by these, he gathered that I was a jovialist, born of a Thursday, and that I shall be a brave Venerian, and get all of my good luck on a Friday.
'Tis strange that a fish day should be a flesh day.
But here comes that notable villain that once preferred me to the alchemist.
So I had an aster, and he would not care what became of me.
Robin, thou shalt see me fit him. So I had a servant. I cared neither for his conditions, his person, nor his qualities. Oh, what's Rafe? Well met!
No doubt you had a warm service with my master, the alchemist.
Oh, it was warm indeed, for the fire had almost burnt out mine eyes. And yet my teeth still watered with hunger, so that my service was both too hot and too cold. I made off only with my slumber thoughts, and so had a full head and an empty belly. But where hast thou been since?
With a brother of thine, I think. He wears such clothes, and they say, brothers seeking of fortunes. 'Tis my brother Dick. I printeth, let us go to him.
Hey, sirrah, what was he doing that he came out with thee?
Oh, he has a new master now that will teach him to make you both his younger brothers.
Aye, thou stands for devising impossibilities. That's as true as thy master could make silver tags of pots of points.
Nay, he will cause you both so he can get the mill to himself.
If he be both our cousins, I shall be his great-grandfather, and Robin shall be his uncle. But, sir, I pray you, take us to him, for I am great-bellied with conceit until I see him.
Come, follow me, and I will lead you to him straight. Bring forth the virgin, the fatal virgin, the fair virgin, if you wish to appease Neptune.
Neptune.
And preserve your country.
Here she cometh, accompanied only with men, because it is a sight unseemly, as all virgins say, to see the misfortune of a maiden, and terrible to behold the fierceness of Agar. That monster!
Accursed Hebe, that being neither fair nor fortunate, thou shouldst be thought most happy and beautiful. Curse thy birth, thy life, thy death, being born to live in danger and having lived to die by deceit. Art thou the sacrifice to appease Neptune and satisfy the custom, the bloody custom ordained for the safety of thy country? Aye, Hebe, poor Hebe, men will have it so whose forces command our weak natures. Nay, the gods will have it so whose powers dally with our purposes. The Egyptians never cut their dates from the tree because they are so fresh and green. It is not wicked to pull roses from the stalks in the garden of Palestine, for then they have so lively a red, and whoso cutteth the incense tree in Arabia before in fall committeth sacrilege. Shall it only be lawful among us in the prime of youth and pride of beauty to destroy both youth and beauty, and what was honored in fruits and flowers as a virtue to violate in a virgin as a vice? But alas, destiny alone, no dispute. Die, Hebe, Hebe, die! Woeful and only accursed Hebe. Farewell, the sweet delights of life, and welcome now the bitter pangs of death. Farewell, you chaste virgins, whose thoughts are divine, whose face is fair, whose fortunes are agreeable to your affections. Enjoy and long enjoy the pleasures of your curled locks, the amiableness of your wished looks, the sweetness of your tuned voices, the content of your inward thoughts, the pomp of your outward shows. Only Hebe bid farewell to all the joys that she conceived and you hoped for, that she possessed and you shall. Farewell, the pomp of princes' courts, whose roofs are embossed with gold, whose pavements are decked with fair ladies. The nights in pleasant streams, where chastity honors affections and commandeth. Yieldeth to desire and congress. Farewell, sovereign of all virtue and goddess of all virtues, Diana, whose perfections are impossible to be numbered and therefore infinite, never to be matched and therefore immortal. Farewell, parents. Yet to be mine, unfortunate parents. How blessed had you been in barrenness. How happy had I been had I not been. Oh. Farewell, life. Vain life. Wretched life. Whose sorrows are long. Whose end is doubtful. Whose misery certain. Whose hopes innumerable. Whose fears intolerable. Come, death, and welcome, death, whom nature could not resist, because... because necessity ruleth nor defer, because destiny hasteth. Come, Agar! Thou insatiable monster of maiden's blood and devourer of beauty's bowels, clutch thyself to thou servant and let my life end thine. Tear these tender joints with thy greedy jaws, these yellow locks with thy black feet, this fair face with thy foul teeth. Why imagest thou thy wanton swiftness? I am fair. I am a virgin. I am ready. Come back on, thou horrible monster, and farewell world, thou viler monster. Get up!
her own life and spoiled all of yours.
We could not find any fairer.
Oh, Neptune will. Take her to her father.
Fortunate Hebe, how shall thy trust thy joy? Nay, unhappy girl, that art not the fairest. Had it not been better for thee to have died with fame than to live with dishonor, to have preferred the safety of thy country and rareness of thy beauty before vanity of the world and sweetness of life. But alas, destiny would not have it so. Destiny could not, for it asketh the beautifulest. I would, Hebe, thou hast been beautifulest.
Come, Hebe, here is no time for us to reason. Maybe it had been best that you weren't found most beautiful.
Without, festered to the death within. therefore. No, too. Be not buried, which can never die, fancy or quench that which must ever burn. Show thyself the same Neptune that I knew thee to be when thou wast a shepherd. And let not Venus' words be vain in thine ears, since thine were imprinted in my heart.
It is known, Venus, that your tongue is as unruly as your thoughts, and your thoughts as unstayed as your eyes. Diana cannot chatter. Venus cannot choose.
It is an honor for Diana to have Venus mean ill when she so speaketh well.
But you shall see I come not to trifle.
Therefore, once again, Neptune, if Venus ever stood thee instead, further thy fancies, or shall at all times be at thy command, let either Diana bring her virgins to a continual massacre, or release Cupid of his martyrdom.
It were unfit that goddess should strive, and it were unreasonable that I should not yield. So therefore, to please both, both attend. Diana, I must honor. Her virtue deserveth no less. But Venus, I must love, I must confess so much. Diana, restore Cupid to Venus, and I will forever release the sacrifice of virgins. If you love your nymphs as she doth her son, or prefer not a private grudge before a common grief, answer what you will do.
I count not the choice hard, for had I 20 Cupids, I would deliver them all to save one virgin, knowing love to be a thing of all the vainest, virginity to be a virtue of all the noblest. I yield. Larissa, bring out Cupid. And now, shall it be said that Cupid saved those he thought to spoil?
I agree to this willingly, for I will be wary how my son wander again. But Diana cannot forbid him to wound.
Yes, chastity is not within the level of his bow.
But beauty is a fair mark to hit.
Well, I'm glad you are agreed, and say Neptune hath dealt well with beauty and chastity.
Here, take your son.
Sir boy, where have you been? Always taken, first by Sappho, now by Diana. How happened it, you unhappy elf?
Coming through Diana's woods and seeing so many fair faces with fond hearts, I thought for my sport to make them smart, and so was taken by Diana.
I am glad I have you.
And I am glad I am rid of him.
But soft, what be these?
Those that have offended thee to save their daughters.
Why, had you a fair daughter?
And the lady's fair daughter.
Where be
in yonder woods, and methinks I see them coming. This is my daughter, my sweet Philida.
And this is my fair Gallathea.
Unfortunate Gallathea, if this be Philida. Accursed Philida, if this be Gallathea. Was all this while thou was enamored of Philida? That sweet Philida?
And couldst thou dote upon the face of a maiden, thyself being one, on the face of fair Gallathea?
Do you both, being maidens, love one another?
I have thought the habit agreeable with the sex, so burned in the fire of mine own fancies.
I had thought that in the attire of a boy there could not have lodged the body of a virgin, and was so inflamed with the sweet desire, which I now find a sour deceit.
Now, things falling out as they do, you must leave these fond affections. Nature will have it so. Necessity must.
I will never love any but Philida. Her love is engraven in my heart with her eyes.
Nor I any but Gallathea, whose faith is imprinted in my thoughts by her words.
One virgin to dote on another, and imagine a constant faith where there can be no cause of affection. How like you this, Venus?
I like well, and allow it.
They shall both be possessed of their wishes, for never shall it be said that nature or fortune shall overthrow love and faith. Is your love unspotted, begun with truth, continued with constancy, and not to be altered till death?
Die, Gallathea, if thy love be not so.
Accursed Phyllida, if thy love be not so.
Suppose all this, Venus. What then?
Then shall it be seen that I can turn one of them to be a man, and that I will.
Is it possible?
What is to love, or the mistress of love, impossible? Was it not Venus that did the like to Iphis and Ianthes? How say ye? Are ye agreed? One to be a boy presently?
I'm content, so I may embrace Gallathea.
I wish it so, so I may enjoy Phyllida.
But soft, daughter. You must know whether I will have you as a son.
Take me with you, Gallathea. I'll keep you as I begat you, a daughter.
Teeters. Let yours be a boy, and if you will, mine shall not.
Nay, mine shall not. For by that means, my young son will lose all his inheritance.
Why, then get him to be a maiden, and then there's nothing lost.
There be such change, and I would Venus could make my wife a man.
Why?
Because she loves always to play with men.
Well, you are both fond, therefore agree to this changing, or suffer your daughters to endure hard chance.
I say, Tyrus, shall I refer to Venus?
I'm content, because she is a goddess.
Neptune, you will not dislike it.
Not I.
Nor you.
Diana.
Not I.
And Cupid shall not.
I will not.
Then let us depart. Neither of them shall know whose lot it shall be till they come to the church door. One shall be. Doth it suffice?
And satisfy us both. Doth it not, Gallathea?
Yes, Phyllida.
Come, Robin. I'm glad I've met with thee. For now we shall make our father laugh at these tales.
What are these that so malapertly thrust themselves into our company?
Oh, forsooth, madam, we are fortune tellers.
Fortune tellers? Tell me my fortune.
Madam, we do not mean fortune tellers. We mean fortune tellers. We will tell you what fortune we have had these past 6 months in the woods.
Let them alone. They be but peevish.
Yet they will be good as minstrels at the marriage to make us all merry.
Ah, ladies, we bear a very good consort.
Can you sing?
Basely.
And you?
Meanly.
And what can you do?
Well, they come when I will tremble.
Then shall you go with us and sing Hymen before the marriage? Are you content?
Content, never better content.
For there we shall be sure to fill our bellies with such capon rumps and some such dainty dishes.
Then follow us.
Go on. 'Tis I only that concludes all. You ladies may see that Venus can make courage, cowardice, constancy, fickleness, modesty, lightness, working things impossible in your sex, and tempering hardest hearts like softest wool. Yield, ladies, yield to love, ladies, which lurketh under your eyelids whilst you sleep and playeth with your heartstrings whilst you wake, whose sweetness never breeds satiety, labor, weariness, nor grief, bitterness. Cupid was begotten in a mist, nursed in clouds and sucking only upon conceits. Confess him a conqueror whom ye ought to regard, sith it is impossible to resist, for this is infallible. That love conquereth all things but itself, and ladies, all hearts but their own.